and his title is A Short Introduction to Cosmic Ray Physics.
Okay. So thank you for being here. Any deep expert in cosmic ray physics? I need somebody that can spot out my mistakes. Because as a matter of fact, I'm a little bit an outsider in the field of cosmic rays. I mean, when you go to a conference in cosmic rays, there are hardcore astrophysicists and those like me that take the cosmic ray route as a route to something else, which is in some aspect fundamental physics. And okay, so if after these lectures you find the topic interesting, a couple of books that you may want to have a look at. There's the book by Tom Geiser, which is a very introductory level book on cosmic rays and particle physics. There's the technical book by Schlickheiser, and then the very extensive book by Berezinski. I took the liberty in this, at least in this introductory lecture that I will do today for you, to borrow some of the material from Pasquale Serpico. I will acknowledge that in the going. So, would you have gone to a conference on cosmic rays in the 20s or in the 30s? Really, that wouldn't have been called a cosmic ray conference, but more a particle physics conference. Because really, cosmic rays was the initial playground to make progresses in particle physics. And let me take some brief historical path. So the business started just little more than 100 years ago with the observation by Victor Hess that the radiation which was discharging electroscopes. What are electroscopes? Well, at the time, the way one measured the electric charge, you charge the apparatus which had to thin plate at the bottom. When it was charged, the thin plate went apart because of electrostatic repulsion. And those kind of apparatus, I mean, you couldn't keep them charged because there was no way of shielding from some radiation that made those kind of thing getting discharged. So people were wondering what kind of radiation was that? Was that some kind of radiation that was emitted from the Earth? Or was some kind of radiation that was coming from above, from the heaven? So Victor Hess was a brave guy who at the time decided to put his electroscope on a balloon and do a high altitude flight. He went up to 6 kilometers. And he noticed that this radiation was going up in intensity while it was going up in the atmosphere. So after an initial dip that is sharply going up, Cole Oster, just 2 years later, went even to higher altitudes and found this beautiful correlation. So these results were pointing to the fact that this radiation was something that was high energy, it was penetrating the atmosphere, it was getting partially absorbed by the atmosphere itself, so if you went up in the atmosphere, the intensity growed. So there was no, people started playing around like, is there any effect from measuring this radiation at night or during the day? When you were facing the sun or when the sun was hidden. No, there was no such effect, and then people started to suspect that this had to be some kind of extrasolar stuff, some kind of cosmic stuff. So Millikan and Cameron in 26 made a mistake, which ended up giving the name cosmic rays to this radiation, because we were measuring in lakes at different altitude how this radiation was absorbed by water, and they concluded in their analysis that that radiation had to be gamma rays. So then they dubbed this radiation cosmic rays, and that's what we call it today as well. Except that was wrong, because it's not mainly gamma rays, it's mainly charged particles. And this was established in 28 and later in 23 by two observations. The fact that the intensity increased with latitude, and then there were three different experiments, including the one by Bruno Rossi, that measured the fact that when you were at the equator, this radiation of cosmic rays was coming more from the west than from the east. How is that? Well, that is explained by the fact that we are measuring these cosmic rays not in an empty environment, but we are measuring it in a background which contains a fairly large magnetic field, the Earth magnetic field, which has a dipolar structure, North Pole, South Pole, and then, you have the line field that goes like this and get parallel here at the equator. So you can just assume that these particles are charged. You compute the Lorentz force on this. You equate to the centrifugal force. And then what you see is that if these particles are less energetic than about 50 GeV, there's a full shadow which is given by the Earth itself on particles of a given charge. In particular, if these particles are positively charged, the Larmor radius that you compute is of this kind and reaches the Earth size for about 50 GeV. So if you sit here and cosmic rays are mainly protons, they will be coming freely from this direction and will not be seen from that direction. And also, since the structure of the magnetic field is a dipole, then these forbidden trajectory are changing with the latitude, and in particular they get parallel to the magnetic field lines at the North Pole. So at the North Pole is more probable to get all particles discharging your oscilloscope. So these are charged particles. And these charged particles, as I was saying before, are absorbed in the atmosphere. So there were observations, again made by Rossi and Auger, independently, that discovered that these high-energy particles are traversing the atmosphere and making huge air showers. So a lot of particles that are in a bunch that comes from one initial interaction point that you can use to reconstruct the energy of the shower. We will see it in a second. Okay. And then I mark here the last milestone, which was by Enrico Fermi, that in 49 developed the first proposal to how to accelerate this cosmic radiation in the galaxy. We'll come back to that. So as I told you, if you went to a particle physics conference in the 30s, that would have been a cosmic ray conference, because people were really using cosmic rays as the accelerators of that time, and they were using this radiation that was coming for free to study how elementary particles were interacting. And in particular, there was a sequence of discoveries using cosmic rays. The most famous one is the discovery by Anderson in 32 of the positron. So he was using stuff like this, which is called a cloud chamber, which is a progenitor of a bubble chamber, is something that contains a fluid that goes into two phases, so it's compressed gas. When it is traversed by an ionizing particle, it changes phase, so you see the track when you take a picture of it in a photographic plate. So this is a picture of a positron, because you have a magnetic field which is oriented outgoing from the plane, and then you have a particle which is bending in this way, and I'm telling you that the track is in this way because you see it has an energy which makes up a orbit which a larger radius here, and then it's ionizing the mean, so it's losing energy and it's getting progressively to shorter and to smaller and smaller radius. So the track is the particle has gone in here and then essentially stopped there. From the stopping, you can measure what's the mass of the particle, how efficient the ionization goes. So Anderson was able to detect a particle which is positively charged and had a mass that was consistent with the electron. And that matched perfectly the prediction by Dirac in 2 years before that the positron had to exist. Okay, then I want to cut the story short, but this is a shopping chart with the other list of phenomena that were discovered with cosmic rays. Pair production in 1933, what was at the time thought to be the Yukawa mediator, but actually the muon in 37, so in 45-46, Conversi, Pacini, and Piccioni showed that it had to be the muon, not the pion. The pion themselves were discovered the year after, and so on and so forth. Up to really the 50s, when the first efficient terrestrial accelerators were devised, and then gradually particle physics shifted out from being a cosmic ray field. And what about striking it back? So that was my initial interest in the field. So there's a renewed interest in using cosmic rays to test fundamental physics, and in particular to discover new particles. And the new particles that we are after are possibly dark matter particles. And the idea is to identify them through the yields of their annihilation or decay. And in particular, if these particles, dark matter particles, are democratic and generate the same amount of matter and antimatter, since antimatter is scarce in our visible universe, there's some opportunity to detect primary antimatter components connected to this dark matter annihilation. So if everything goes well, at the end of these lectures, I want to give you a flavor of why people got excited looking at this positron fraction, or can get excited about looking at this antiproton fraction. So antiproton fraction means ratio of the flux of antiprotons over the flux of proton. This is the ratio of the flux of positron over electron plus positron. And there's some path, so to say, standard, which is telling you that you should go like this or like that, while there is some little excess. So we'll try to discuss whether this is an excess and how it comes that it makes sense to think that this is a valuable tool for particle physics. So to make a step forward, I really have to tell you what I'm talking about. So I have to introduce a little bit about detection targets and detection methods. So this is the propaganda plot for cosmic rays, which is putting an intensity, cumulative intensity spectrum of all species of cosmic rays in a plot which is as a really scary logarithmic scales. Okay, there are about 32 orders of magnitude in this direction, and something like 11 in this direction. That's roughly speaking, really the beauty of this playground, in the sense that you see, you have something that, if you put it in this huge scale, looks like well, a fairly good power law. This is e to the minus 3, this green line that you can hardly see. And you see the red dots, which are the data, fits more or less on this green line. And they go all the way to, say, 100 MeV. And this 100 MeV has some meaning because it corresponds, roughly speaking, to the energy at which the sun messes up the playground, in the sense that there's this outflow of particles or plasma from the sun, which really prevents you to receive cosmic radiation at energies that are lower than roughly this 100 MeV. And then it goes all the way up to this 10 to the 20 electron volts, which, as we will discuss later, is really to be considered some kind of high energy cutoff in two ways. On the acceleration side, maybe, but mostly on the fact that, again, above these energies, cosmic rays cannot reach you, cannot do the path from the sources to you. So it's a power law with two main features here. So now this is getting a little bit obsolete because when we have much better measurement of this, and there are features all over the places, but historically these are the two main ones. There is a softening of the spectrum here around 10 to the 15 electron volts. This is called the GNI, and there's an hardening around 10 to the 19 electron volt around here. And this is probably an imprint of the fact that you are talking about either different cosmic ray species, which are more efficiently produced at different energies, or you are talking about different cosmic ray population. And actually, it's both. So when you, I wanted to stress something else in this plot. This plot is scary from an experimental point of view, because really, when you convert this flux into a number of events that you expect in your detector, you go from up here, which is a scale corresponding to detecting one particle if you have a 1 meter square of effective area per second, to the Ni region, which is one particle per meter square per year, to this region here, which is one particle per kilometer cube per year. So when you try to go into detail and, for instance, measure the different composition in the total cosmic ray flux, so as I was telling you, cosmic rays are mostly, at least at low energy, protons, and then there is some helium component, carbon, etc., but note that this is not on scale because there are these rescaling factors which come paired to these fluxes. So when you do want to do this exercise, it's a very different exercise if you do it at 1 GV, at 100 TV, like in this case, or at 10 to the 20 electron volts. So roughly up to 100 TV or so, you are able to do it really with a particle physics detector that you put on a satellite or you attach it to the International Space Station and wait long enough to collect statistics. But when you go to this region above here, above 100 TV, really you have to go back to the trick of using the atmosphere as your detector. So let me sketch the very briefly the two. So I just took two examples of particle physics detectors that have been put in space. There is, for instance, the Fermi Large Area Telescope, and that's just a piece of material that everything that it does is to look for a gamma ray that is coming this side. It hits multiple layers of silicon, and this multiple layer of silicon make this gamma ray pair produce. So you convert the gamma ray into an electron-positron pair, and then here you have a calorimeter which measures the energy of the electron and the positron by stopping them. Then there's some stuff that is characteristic of particle physics detector, even at accelerator. And really, if you want to measure cosmic rays, charge cosmic rays, you have to use a detector which indeed doesn't look very different from what you use at LHC, in the sense that you have instruments which are put in a strong magnetic field to tell the difference between a positive and negative charges. You have instruments that measure with accuracy the passing of a high energy species from top to bottom. So they measure the velocity of the particle, so they measure the charge of the particle, and so on. You have a calorimeter and so on. So this is the other big experiment in space, the alpha magnetic spectrometer, which has been flying attached to the space station now since 4 years. And the other tool is, as I was telling you, instead using the atmosphere. Okay, so the idea is that you are looking at this shower of particles. This shower of particles is not disconnected, but is coming from by backtracing initial interaction point, and by looking at the shower, you want to retrace what's the energy of this initial incoming particle, possibly what is the direction of it. And then what you have to do is to, in this indirect measurement, is really to understand what is making up your shower. And there are two main cases. The case when this is an electromagnetic shower, so this is initiated by a photon that pair produces, and then you have an electromagnetic cascade, or whether you are starting with an hadron, like a proton, and you have a cascade with hadron and mesons, and partial conversion into an electromagnetic cascade, and so on. So once you suppose you know what the atmosphere is made of, and you know it, it's essentially a business of implementing a dedicated Monte Carlo that knows about quantum electrodynamics and quantum chromodynamics at these energies. Okay, do we know quantum electrodynamics at this energy? Well, we have good reason to say yes. Do we know how to calibrate QCD at all energies which are of interest for cosmic ray physics? Well, the answer is actually no, because we have been able to calibrate it up to the energies that are reached at accelerators in And for instance, there was a great job done after the first run at the LHC, but still you have to deal with extrapolations. So, yes. Okay, so that's a good question, because she was asking about how in sort of detail you can understand these showers where you have a single particle, multiple producing other states and so on. So how do you make this plot or this plot? So this is a plot of a simulation for an electromagnetic shower. This is a plot for a simulation of a hadronic shower. So since I thought that maybe in this first lecture I didn't want all of you to fall asleep following my slide, I thought that this was a good point to complement this with some calculation that we can do at least at a rough level with paper and pen. And I want to discuss this Eitler model. For cascades, which is something that Mr. Eitler developed in the 50s, essentially because he didn't have a Monte Carlo to use, and he was trying to find some tool that gave some feeling for why an electromagnetic shower looks in reality like this and why an hadronic shower looks like that. So, and that's also fun because it gives me the opportunity to introduce some of the jargon that cosmic ray physicists give for granted and particle physicists don't understand. Okay, so let's start with an electromagnetic shower. So I'm starting with a photon. Okay, this photon has an energy which I call E naught. Okay, so this photon is traveling through the atmosphere and is feeling the Coulomb interactions that are due to the nucleons that are sitting out there in the atmosphere. So in the Coulomb fields of this nucleon, what it can do is to produce a pair of E plus, E minus. Okay? So there is some conversion probability, and the conversion probability is usually given in cosmic ray physics like what is called the grammage. Lambda. Okay? So there's a characteristic grammage. What is the grammage? Is an integrated column density along propagation. So it's essentially how much material you are transversing before something happens to this particle. So it's something that usually is measured in grams per centimeter cube. Okay, it's really density times length. Okay? So, what we are measuring here is exactly this grammage, okay? Because you have a step one, which is this one, which is happening at some grammage, And then what will happen is that these electrons and positrons are not going to just propagate in the vacuum, right? They are still in the atmosphere of the Earth, so they as well feel these Coulomb fields connected to nuclei. So by Bremsstrahlung, what they do is to emit a photon. Okay, so that was step one. This is step two, which on average is going to happen at a given grammage. And then you understand what's going to happen. You're going to have a step three, in which this one is going to pair produce. This one is going to do Bremsstrahlung, pair produce, Bremsstrahlung, blah, blah, blah. Okay? So if you are measuring the depth in the atmosphere in this grammage language, and this you call it X, so the number of steps N is just what? Is just this total X divided by the length of each step. So it's X divided by lambda. Okay? The number of particles that I get let me call it big N at a given X is what? At each step, each particle is producing two particles. So this is just 2 to the n. Okay? So this is 2 to the x divided by lambda. What about the energies? The mean energy at a given x is what? Well, if we are democratic and say that at each pair splitting we are sharing the initial energy, splitting them into from one mother into two daughters, then the mean energy is nothing but E naught divided by this 2 to the x over lambda. So is this going forever? No, this is not going forever, because you see, this is telling you that the energy of the mean energy of the particle is fastly decreasing as you go to along this cascade. And while we were considering just pair production, and Bremsstrahlung, there's an H which I never know where to put. Yeah, whatever. Okay, modulus the H. So these were these two processes. These are efficiently up to you are at the stage you are at some kind of high energy. While when you deplete the energy by this proliferation of particles, you end up in a regime in which collisions take over. So the particle that is somewhere here in the shower, what it tends to do is not going ahead with the proliferation, but is losing energy continuously and at the end of the day maybe stopping. So there will be some characteristic energy E of collision such that when you are in the regime that E is smaller than, the mean E is smaller than this E collision, you're going in this regime, while what I call the high E is when this is larger than this E collision. Okay? So there's going to be a maximum number of particles, so this N of X is going to saturate on an N max, which under this democratic law I've been assuming will be just set by the fact that I've been splitting the energy, initial energy, into a mean energy which matches this condition that stops proliferation. So there will be some X max connected to this thing, which is going, I'm just plugging that in here, and I find that N, X mass is just lambda, the log of 2 of E naught divided by EC. So lambda and lambda and EC are something that is characteristic of the medium in which you are doing this shower. So for the atmosphere, you have to make up what is the case for nitrogen, blah, 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 all the components of the atmosphere. And on average, you get that this characteristic grammage is something like 35 grams per centimeter cube, while this threshold energy at which you stop reproducing is around 80 MeV. So what I'm seeing there, just in color coding, is essentially a plot in which, let me put the axis like this. This is increasing depth. This is the point at which you had interaction, the first interaction. And this is the number of particles. So what is happening is that along the path that the shower is making, there is some branch, which is this branch here, which then saturates at some N max. Corresponding to some X mass. And then what you see in the atmosphere is that the density of these electromagnetic states is going down. So that's that. So you see, if you have an instrument that is able to map this point here, then that instrument is measuring the energy of the incident particle. Okay. So there are refinements in these that have to do with the fact that energies are not really always split in this democratic way, that actually should take the pair production and the correct Bremsstrahlung together with collisions at the same time. Right? So there is some reshuffling, but this is really QED, and this we have very well under control. So electromagnetic shower, we are going to get measure energy in a delightful way. What about the plot on the right, hadronic showers? Yes. Sorry, I didn't get the question. Sorry. Why is it easy to measure this X max? You are asking. Yeah, really. You have to make a model of the atmosphere. You have to know what the atmosphere is made of. Okay, so you have a distribution of Coulomb fields associated to each individual element. I mean, the atmosphere is essentially ionized. Okay, it's the cosmic rays themselves which are keeping them ionized. So it's really an exercise of non-relativistic QED. Yes. No, that is much suppressed. Okay, you have it, but I mean you compute the probability. The probability it goes like no, it's not really like that, no, because you are not producing on-shell quarks. No, you really have to produce two showers. Two hadron showers. Okay, and then the probability for that is really relevant. So hadron showers matter when you start with them. So hadrons will have these hadronic cascades. And plus eventually, oh gosh, plus eventually the electromagnetic ones. So you have this proton that is propagating in the ambient field in the atmosphere, and then it is splitting. Okay? And let's make it simple. Let's say that these hadronic cascades are essentially just something that, at the end of the day, produces pions. So you have pi plus, pi minus, pi zero. Okay? These ones are going to go ahead with another hadron cascade. So I have hadron cascade. This one is doing what? This one is going to go to decay. So it's going to go into two photons. So this one is, as I said, mixing up the process because this one is starting an electromagnetic cascade. And then, as I just replied, it's a one-way road in the sense that once you end up in an electromagnetic cascade, it's very improbable to get a contribution from a hadronic cascade. So what you are depleting electromagnetically stays in the picture that I wrote on the other side of the blackboard. So again, it's going to go in steps, right? So again, you will have a number of steps. And the difference is that you are splitting energy in hadrons and in an electromagnetic component. So at each step, suppose again to be democratic, you generate the same number of pi plus, pi minus, and pi zero. So the hadronic energy is in each step 2/3, which multiplies n, which multiplies the initial energy E naught. The electromagnetic component is 1 minus this one. Okay, and then you see that from these formulas that since from here you're not coming back, in very few steps you are mostly depleting your energy again electromagnetically. So this plot is telling you that there are some branches, some main branches which correspond to this hadronic lines, and then you attach these showers with many particles that are the electromagnetic lines. So again, you can do a computation of what's the mean energy that you are putting in the hadronic part as you go down in depth, and that's going to be this E naught divided by, okay, I told you here that I'm democratic, but what I have to model is that what is the multiplicity of this democracy. Let me write this multiplicity number of pions and pi plus and pi minus that are generated each step as this new naught. So then the mean energy is the mean in an event divided by the number of the number of total particles that I'm generating. So again, I have a depletion of energy, even this in this hadronic component. And again, I'm going to have a threshold effect. And the threshold is when I break this link pi plus pi minus hadronic cascade. When do I break it? I break it when at a given energy it will be more probable that these guys just decay into a mu plus mu minus and corresponding neutrino. Again, it's a threshold effect because you have some typical decay energy at which this gets at energy lower than this, it gets more probable to go to this branch. And this branch is again a final branch because what you generate are these very energetic muons. Muons are very penetrating particles. They just go straight through the atmosphere. You need lead to stop a muon. So what you generate here is just what eventually you would receive on the ground in a detector. So you will have You have again a maximum number of pi plus pi minus, which is just applying that formula over there, is the log of E naught divided by ED. divided by the log of mu plus minus times 3 divided by 2. And then I can just connect to the number of muons that I'm getting out of this hadronic shower, which will be equal to the number, the maximum number of this pi plus pi minus. And that is just going to be this multiplicity to the n maximum. So when you put things together, you get a formula which is the analogous of this formula, which is that the log of the number of muons is equal to the log of E naught divided by ED, and then there is a coefficient in front which is just the log of nu plus minus divided by the log of n nu times 3 divided by 2. So now you have to know something about hadronic showers, and you need to estimate what is this ED and this number here. This number here boils down to be about 0.85. So again, if you have a detector which somehow is able to estimate this number of muons that you get in the shower, then you have a measure of the energy of the initial state. So this first part, you get order right when you do it in this naive way. This second part is much more tricky, no? Because there's more than this step. This threshold, you have to play a little bit with care. Then what you do is to do a Monte Carlo about what you know about QCD at a given energy. So at least I hope I conveyed a feeling that it does make sense to look at what happens at the bottom of this shower to understand what's the energy of the incoming cosmic ray. And then that's what people do in very different ways. So these showers in the atmosphere, they are detected, for instance, looking at the cone of Cherenkov light which is emitted in the shower. So that will have some characteristic shape given an electromagnetic shower or an hadronic shower. And then if you have a detector on Earth, which is essentially a large dish mirror which is pixelized and looks at the shape of this Cherenkov light, you have a detection of your event. This is in particular interesting for gamma rays at the energies of, say, few hundred GeV to few tens of TeV, and it's the technique applied by the so-called air Cherenkov telescopes. You can look at another way these showers shine, which is the so-called fluorescence light. What is fluorescence light? You have these photons that are floating around. These photons excite nitrogen molecules in the atmosphere, and these molecules de-excite in a slow way, emitting light at a much lower frequency, in the infrared. Okay? So you have this powerful shower. This powerful shower is making this transition on nitrogen all over around it, and then you look at the infrared light with a dedicated, again, a telescope on Earth, which is matching where this infrared light is coming from, what's the intensity, what's the distribution. If you do it, you have to do it, if you want to be careful, with at least two of these telescopes to really reconstruct a 3D shape of the shower. And that's very efficient. Or you can do it more brute force by just putting detectors on the ground and look at what is left from this shower when it hits the ground. And that will be particularly efficient if you want to track hadronic cascades, because I was telling you the hadronic cascade end up with these muons. It's very hard to get rid of. And then the good part is that if you equip a large area of the ground with something that can detect muons, then you can reconstruct the shape of the shower on the ground. So, for instance, there are two main experiments that do this at the high energy end. These are the telescope array in the northern hemisphere, and this older and bigger brother, the Pierre Roger Observatory. And for instance, Pierre Roger has just some water tanks, and it looks for the Cherenkov light of these muons when they go through the tank. So actually, a good way to do it is to combine everything together. So Pierre Roger has this water Cherenkov I just mentioned, many of them covering an effective area which is remarkably large, 3,000 kilometers. It has these fluorescent telescopes. It has also some underground muon detector. The muons can penetrate underground for some depth. There is another technique of detecting this shower, which is detecting the radio sound from this shower. Believe it or not, it's a very efficient that as well. And then you plug all these together with some station that monitors carefully the atmosphere, because of course this number that I'm giving here is a mean number, but then there could be high pressure, low pressure, et cetera, et cetera. So the atmosphere is continuously changing. You have to continuously calibrate your Monte Carlo to the ambient condition. So then this is, for instance, a beautiful event which is detected stereoscopically. So here is the X mass detected looking at the fluorescence light, and then this event is hitting the ground, very many tanks, and based on the intensity of the radiation with respect to the distance from the central tank that is hit, you can estimate in a redundant way the energy. The energy is estimated here, is estimated here. You compare, and you can cross-calibrate. So, okay, this is another experiment, Casimir. I don't want to go too much into detail, but doing this, you can also see something I forgot. You can also, to tell you, this process here is something that you can predict for a proton, and then you can scale up for heavier and heavier elements, assuming that they are some kind of bound state of proton and neutrons, and that they get broken while they propagate in the atmosphere. So there's some characteristic imprint of this X max depending on whether you started the cascade with a proton or with the highest element that is conceivable to have in these primary cosmic rays, which is iron. I will say why this is the case in the next lecture. Okay, so this is the lines are your Monte Carlos, which are tuned on what we know about the QCD. And as I was telling you, this is improved Monte Carlos after the first run at the LHC, which really changed a little bit the business. And then you see, this is a compilation of data from Pierre Auger Observatory from, say, 10 to the 17 to 10 to the 19.5, 10 to the 20 electron volts. And there is some hint of the fact that composition is varying, possibly on the light side. So, yeah. So this is a plot that I put it there because up to this recalibration by the LHC, there were different experiments claiming different spectral compositions and also different energy calibrations. And now all of this has gone away. And for instance, Telescope Array and Auger agree very well. So it's a technique which is really getting mature and trustable. And I want to stress it once again, is a technique which makes us go above the energy frontier of terrestrial accelerators. Because if I just do a naive comparison in which I put the center of mass energy of the LHC in proton-proton collision is something that stands in here. I convert it into high energy proton colliding with atmosphere and is putting me somewhere here, 10 to the 17 electron volts. But as I told you, we are having events up to 10 to the 20 electron volts. Okay, so we have cosmic rays and we know how to measure them, their composition and energy quite well. So then, what do we learn from them? So the first thing one has to take into account is that you're doing this business in the atmosphere, in the solar system, in the galaxy. You're doing this business in something which is very different from the vacuum. You're doing something in an environment which can give you many back reactions. Okay, and this is my first slide borrowed from Serpico. Thank you. So you have to take into account the different components that are there polluting your cosmic ray propagation when they go out in the interstellar medium. So the interstellar medium is stuff which is dilute but not so irrelevantly dense. It has a density of around one atom per centimeter cube, which if you are integrating up to long length scales is not irrelevant. What is that? It's mainly atomic and molecular hydrogen, and then there is some heavier molecules that are in the jargon of cosmic rays called dust. Okay? So dust, this is not in a sense you would give it to in a cosmology course. This is some stuff which has some degree of freedom which can dissipate energy in a different way with respect to single atomic transitions that are going on in the gas, so to speak. So if you are talking about an object like the Milky Way is full of light, okay? This was the next point. The fact that this dust is interactively with your light propagation and can obscure something about your Milky Way. Okay, so visible light is partially absorbed. Infrared and radio light can go through. So if you want to learn about the galaxies, it's better that you go to a radio telescope rather than the Hubble Space Telescope. And on top of this dust and gas, there is this interstellar radiation field, which is a healthy population of photons of in general low frequency, going from the ultraviolet to the visible to the infrared. And again, they have a typical density which is not irrelevant. It's of the order of the electron volt per centimeter cube. Finally, you have a magnetic field that is permeating in the galaxy, and this has a strength of a few microgauss, and this is actually what is most relevant, as we will see in the next lecture, for propagation of cosmic rays, because it prevents cosmic rays from going on straight lines. Okay, so this is just a pie chart with a spectrum of the galaxy, a map of the galaxy at different wavelengths. I put this list over here if you're not too familiar with conversion between wavelength and energies. But you see, it's an interplay of what is can freely propagate in the interstellar medium, like, for instance, these radio observations, and what you can really observe from Earth, because even the atmosphere, as we just studied, is playing the role of absorbing and re-emitting stuff. So, for instance, if you're looking at visible light, it's okay to have a larger telescope on Earth, but you have a little bit distortion, so if you want to have a really clean view, you have to go out of the atmosphere. While for radio telescopes, well, there's the fortunate coincidence that the atmosphere is transparent to radio waves, and then we can build these huge networks of radio telescopes to detect very different, very long wavelengths. This is a picture, again, expanding plot of what I was showing before. You have this large radio emission. We'll talk about that. There is an optical counterpart, which, as I told you, is mostly obscured. The galaxy is beautifully shining in gamma rays. And then if you take this Fermi particle physics detector and put it in space, this doesn't quarrel with the atmosphere, and you can make these beautiful plots. So then one could ask, okay, why am I bothering about so many different species? I want to retract it all. Wouldn't it be okay to say, okay, gamma rays I know how to detect. Let's go just for that. Well, the point is that life is more tricky. And, okay, you have this environment, and this environment is connected to some horizons for the given species that you are considering. So let me sketch, for instance, this one, which is the gamma ray horizon. I told you that in the interstellar medium, there is an interstellar radiation field which is quite rich and prominent. So, unfortunately, what can happen with a very energetic gamma ray propagating in the interstellar medium is to eat this background photon and then pair produce. Okay? It's something that go to the center of mass and estimate that goes with scaling with this energy of the energy gamma ray, energy of the background photon. It's something that has a kinematical threshold, And also it has a cross section which is very peaked at this typical energy connected to the threshold. So effectively what you are resonating on is a frequency which is sort of monochromatically mapped onto the energy of the incident photon. So if you have a TV photon, that's absorbed by an infrared photon. And that's bad, because as I told you, we have plenty of these infrared photons. So, okay, I cut it out the scale, but this is the density of this interstellar radiation field versus wavelength, and you have these three peaks. There's, of course, the CMB, there's the far infrared, the near infrared, ultraviolet there, doesn't matter. It doesn't matter because when you look at the energetics, one TV is eating this peak here and is making the propagation, the absorption length of a TV photon shrink from essentially infinity, that is around 100 GV, to a scale that is of the order of a few hundreds megaparsec. Even more, if you go to 100 TV photons, you hit this peak, and that shrinks to few megaparsec. And then you have this saturation scale at this 10 to the 15 electron volts. So what you have is a real gamma ray horizon, which doesn't show up in the plot, but is this line here. So this is the given redshift. What's the energy at which you have an attenuation that goes like 1 over E? And then you see, if we are looking at a source that is situated at the galactic center, we can hope to detect up to 10 to the 15 electron volt. But if we look at the brightest extragalactic source, which is Markarian 501, Markarian 501 has an attenuation length already of few tens of TeV. And if you go to further back in time, so to larger and larger distances, you have absorption that is happening at energies that are below the TeV. Here is even 100 GeV, so you are not hoping to see what happens from the first stars looking at gamma rays. Those gamma rays are long absorbed before they get to you. Okay, just for fun, to get back to particle physics. Okay, something I forgot to mention here. So there's an ongoing debate, actually, whether we have seen some anomalies about these TV gamma ray detections. So there's been some hint that maybe we have detected sources that are too far to be consistent with this picture that you don't see. So that the opacity of the universe is not on this line, but is slightly above it. And then there are a plethora of other possible anomalies. So one idea in connection to these anomalies is that particle physics is striking back, and you invent some particle that has a coupling to photon that is of the same kind as axion photon coupling. I believe you have had some discussion about axions yesterday. So these are not dark matter axions, are some axions like power states which do the job of, in a magnetic field, converting your photon into an axion. So you have a photon, this photon is converted into an axion. The axion doesn't interact with the interstellar radiation field, so it can just propagate on a further distance than it would have been a photon. And then it may also be the case that before reaching you, it converts back, and you are actually seeing this emitted photon like a final photon in your detector. So this conversion probability depends on magnetic field, blah, blah, blah. I don't want to go into the details. You have some conversion probability maximized for a mass scale for these axion-like particles of the order of 10 to the 9 electron volts. And then, okay, you can play around with the prediction that you have for this model. So instead of seeing a spectrum for an absorbed Arctic galactic nuclei that would be like that, you see something that shines up at higher energy and has some funny feature at lower energy. This puts you, this is in a plane in which you put the coupling and mass of your axion-like particle. This works in a region of the parameter space which is around here, and as I was telling you, is not the parameter space for the QCD axion as dark matter, which is this one. Okay, let me finish with another horizon, which is instead connected to protons. Okay, protons, again, they emitted in the sources, propagate in the interstellar medium. And again, there are these photons around which are bugging them. And in particular, in this case, what matters, since I will be talking about extragalactic sources, are cosmic microwave background photons. So the interaction for this this process goes on resonance when you hit this delta resonance. So the cross-section is making a jump of a couple of orders of magnitude. And then this conversion here gets very efficient. So to reach resonance with a low energy photon, you really need to go to very high energy protons. And then if you're talking about cosmic microwave background, the energy of the proton has to be in this range of 10 to the 20 electron volts. So this is coming back. So what's happening? This photon, this proton is interacting with a photon. It's scattering to lower energy, producing a pion. The pion dissipate energy into producing gamma rays. And these gamma rays are, at the end of the day, absorbed. So you have a so-called ultra-energy cosmic ray horizon, which is when this goes on resonance into a loud final state. You can make up the energetic. That's happening starting around 10 to the 18 electron volt, getting more efficient at 10 to the 19 electron volt, and saturating at 10 to the 20 electron volt. So in units of this attenuation length, the same quantity I was showing before for photons that you couldn't see, this attenuation length is getting from being very large, irrelevant for propagation, down to the 10 to the 3 megaparsec scale, around 10 to the 19 electron volts, and really down to tens of megaparsec for 10 to the 20 electron volt. This will depend on whether you have this high energy stuff, which is protons, or heavy stuff like iron. For comparison, this is the one for gamma rays. Gamma rays, they are always irrelevant. They are always absorbed. This cutoff takes the name from the three guys that discovered it in '66, Grisen, Sapsekin, and Kuzmin. They predicted pretty much as soon as the cosmic microwave background was discovered 2 years before. And so it's the so-called GZK cutoff. And let me finish with the detection of the GZK cutoff. So there was a lot of excitement in the early late 90s, because the first experiment that had actually the power to detect 10 to the 20 electron volts didn't see the cutoff. So there were a flood of papers written for how to explain the absence of this threshold effect based on quantum gravity, blah, blah, blah. Unfortunately, that cutoff is there, and there's not a kind of imprint from fundamental physics. So IRIS, Piaget Observatory Telescope Array have clearly detected. So there is this attenuation of the intensity that is going on at around 10 to the 20 electron volts. And still the game is not over, because I was showing you this this plot with the composition. Actually, it was from the same data set that I'm showing here. And then you see, when you try to model this this cutoff with either protons or iron, it really doesn't work very well with explaining all of it with either of the two. So there's some interesting physics that is going on at this 10 to the 20 electron volts. And if I can mention a very last thing, this 10 to the 19, 10 to the 20 electron volt window is really a fortunate coincidence, in the sense that it's a hope that we have to do ultra-energy cosmic ray astronomy. So why is this open window for astronomy? I told you, there are magnetic fields in the interstellar medium. There are magnetic fields in the galaxy. And then if I estimate what's the Larmor radius connected to a magnetic field of galactic size, which is of the order of the microgauss, then that's of the order of the parsec if you have an energy of the order of 10 to the 15 electron volts. But it's getting larger than the size of the galaxy when you go to these few 10 to the 19 electron volts. And in the same way, it's more cumbersome because you have to do to predict it somehow from first principles, since we haven't measured it yet. But you can estimate that the deflection from the extragalactic magnetic fields is also at the verge of being irrelevant. And then, as I told you, it's this regime in which you have an attenuation length which is getting small. So this means that you're going to see only nearby sources. You're not going to pile up on a huge number of sources. So there's some hope that in this small volume you test, you are seeing a single sources which make up some anisotropy in the flux. And so people are searching for hot spots, spots in the sky when you get more, a larger flux. This intensity of flux is color-coded here. And there is one marginal hot spot in the telescope array data in a position which is consistent with Ursa Minor cluster. If you go to the southern hemisphere, so to the Pierre Auger, there's a warm spot, I would say, in Centaurus A. So this is like 4 sigma. This is like 3 sigma. If you try to correlate with what we know about the large-scale structure in the near vicinity to us, so you take some catalog of distribution of galaxies and you chop out what's within 50 megaparsec, you have these dots. And then, unfortunately, you see that the correlation between the dots and the hot spots, or even the hot spots and the nearest galaxy cluster, is not very good. So we are still not doing ultra-energy cosmic ray astronomy, but we will have to live and see for more statistics. And I think that's a point I want to break.